Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Pap Laszlo Sport Arena in beautiful Budapest, Hungary, for a live coverage of the gold medal match at the Dalo Group Women's EHF Final Four. It's Chris O'Reilly here with you for this final between Rostov Don and Juri Audieto KC. Juri here for the fourth year in a row in the final game, while Rostov Don made it for the very first time after their semi-final victory over Metz. It's their second appearance in Budapest. But they finally made it to the final after overcoming Metz, who also lost today's bronze medal match. A very entertaining bronze medal match as well. Brilliant play from both Metz and the winners, Vipers Kristiansand. And hopefully we'll have a similarly entertaining and close final here, which begins in half an hour's time. And as we look at the Jura players, who are the back-to-back defending champions of this competition. They are the favorites coming into this one, and they were very, very impressive in their semi-final yesterday with a 9-goal victory over Vipers Kristiansand, which we'll take a look at how they got that victory in a second. So Juri Audieto KC made it look easy in the semi-final of this Dalo Group Women's EHF Final Four, going to a 9-goal victory over Vipers with 13 different goal scorers as well, really spreading out the love and attack, and all of them getting decent court time, also a decent rest as well in the build-up to this final. As I mentioned before, it is their fourth consecutive appearance in the Women's EHF Champions League final. After the 2016 defeat on penalties to CSM Bucuresti, they have been unstoppable in Europe, winning back-to-back titles. And here they are with as impressive a squad as ever, added, of course, by the big boost of the return of Nora Merck from her ACL worries over the last year and a half. She's back and made a brief appearance in the semi-final as well. She may need to play a bit more today, as only two left-handers are left in the squad for Jura today. We'll see as the game progresses, but looking throughout the squad here, well, it's a plethora of world-class names. Looking through the goalkeepers alone, with Amandine Lenord, Cardi Grimsbø, and Ava Kiss, who was the hero at the end of the final against Vardar last year. The backcourt as well, with Annemette Hansen, Eduarda Amarim, Veronica Kristiansen, Stine Hoftedal, Mika Kroot, and Nora Merck. I could go on and on. Also, Susanna Tomori. The two line players, Kari Pratset, who was the top scorer in the semi-final yesterday, who has a lot of skill, a lot of speed on the line. And then you have the big Karina Pintea, who was a dominant force at the Women's EHF Euro back in December before she signed for Jura. So talent all over the squad there, and that's not even with me mentioning the wing players. It's going to be a big challenge for this Rostov side, who had to give it their all, but they have a secret weapon up their sleeve in Ambrose Martin. He knows better than anyone how Jura ticks. And the big thing for them is that they improved upon last season's semi-final defeat. They're into the final, and here's how they did it. So that's how Rostov Don secured their passage to their very first final. And it was the narrowest of victories as well. After a formidable first half where they took a 7-goal lead, they were really pushed all the way by Metz in the end. But a save with 2 minutes to go from a penalty from Maisa Pessoa proved to be the difference in the end. Anna Vekireva with an impressive 7-goal haul as well, despite being marked out of the game in the second half and also suffering ankle injuries on both ankles. That'll be a big question mark over her fitness today. But at least from the warm-up, it looks like she is okay. And I think it'll take a lot more than a few rolled ankles to stop her from playing in this final. Rostov, who have been building up to this moment for at least 4 years. Over the years, they've had ups and downs. They've been close to reaching the Final Four on a couple of occasions. Had one very disappointing season where they were knocked out in the group matches. They finally reached Budapest last year, but then had a disappointing semi-final. But here they are. They're in the decider. And 60 minutes separate them from making history. The top players to look out for Rostov Don today. Lois Abing, number 10 in the left-back position. Anna Sen, number 8, who can play left-back and also on the line if needed. Victoria Borshenko had a very good game in the centre-back position, number 99, yesterday. Anna Vekireva, number 13, at right-back. And Yulia Manigarova, number 6, on the wing. Also, their goalkeepers, Maisa Pessoa and Anna Sedoykina, will need a big, big day today. And as the two teams arrived in the arena in the build-up to this game, we had a chance to speak to a player from each team briefly, which we'll hear in a few seconds' time.
When people say it would be boring if Gia wins again, what would you tell them, especially as it's your first time here?
Well, for me, I'm new here, so it's not boring for me.
Did you prepare anything special for Rostov in particular?
Yes, of course, they have good players and they run a lot, and we have to be tough in defense against them.
If you win the final, what will be the first thing you will do?
I will think of my dad and I will lift the trophy.
They have a completely team. Like they can, they have changed the, all the posts in the team, and we don't have that. But I have a good feeling that we can fight and we can show, you know. And this is about belief. So we, Ambrose know how to talk with us, and he know the way. So he's showing to us. And I start think and feel like 3 years ago when I played with HSMA, and was the same situation, you know. So it's just about to believe, and they have a great team, but you had also a great team, and I think that today will be a nice fight. Yeah.
And if you win this final, what is the first thing you will do afterwards?
If you win?
If you win.
Oh my God. This winning for me mean a lot, because today is the Mother's Day, and it will be for my mom for sure. I think for the girls also, so it will be very special day, and because it's, we sure the girls, all of them have children home, they have husband, you know, the Russian girls, and I have my family in Brazil. So this will be to them, you know, for my family, for my mother especially, for my girlfriend. So. For my family, so is this. I feel really positive, and I have a good feelings, and we are ready to fight. Yeah.
Thank you, and good luck for that. Thanks.
Thank you, Eva Sippel, for the sideline reporting before the game, and very special words from Maisa Pessoa, who, as she said, was the hero from the penalty shootout 3 years ago, as Chesima Bucuresti shocked Jiří Audieto KC and won the title. Since then, Jur have been the dominant force in Europe, looking for their third consecutive victory. And this all-star team, led by Gabor Dany, who is in his first season as head coach of the team, coming up against his old master, Ambrose Martín, Spanish coach who has won 4 Women's EHF Champions League titles with Jur, hoping for his 5th and the 1st with Rostov Don. And you're already making their way off court. They're satisfied with their build-up for this game. And Rostov Don getting a few final hits in, getting those bodies ready for what is guaranteed to be a very physical and very hard-fought 60 minutes or maybe more of handball here. In the final game, the gold medal match of the Delo Group Women's EHF Final Four. And the vast majority of this 12,500 capacity Pap Laszlo Sport Arena in Budapest is full. Nobody who has a ticket for this event will want to miss this game. We're already treated to a classic in the bronze medal game, as Vipers Kristiansand won bronze against Metz. You saw how much it meant to these two teams. Just how much will it mean to these two sets of players to win gold this Sunday afternoon in Budapest? And Rostov Don also finished with their warm-up now. You have to wonder whether fatigue will have a part to play in this game, with Rostov playing the second match yesterday and also playing with fewer players overall compared to Jura, who really spread the load around as they could afford to do with a comfortable victory over Vipers. Rostov had no such luck, and so Ambrose Martín and his players will have to produce something special today if they are to overthrow the defending champions and the favorites coming into this game. And we are just about 16 minutes away from throw-off here. The podium in the middle of the court has been set, which means we're almost ready for the final opening show of this Delo Group Women's EHF Final Four. And Jura, who have been in this situation so many times in the past, in the 5 previous Women's EHF Final Four events, they've been here on 4 occasions. They've won the title on 3 of those occasions. They're back again, and they know what it takes to win the title. Even the players who are new this season, they're all coming from experienced clubs and have had their own personal experiences of Olympic, World, European titles. Rostov, well, internationally very experienced as well. But as we know, this event is a completely different kettle of fish. And you have to wonder what is going through the minds of all of these players as they're just 15 minutes away from throw-off. But as the lights go down, I will allow you to enjoy this opening show before we get the final of the Women's EHF Champions League underway. So the stage is set for the final of the Women's EHF Champions League, the gold medal match here at the Delo Group Women's EHF Final Four. Rostov-Don in their very first final in Europe's elite club competition, taking on the team who've been through it over and over again.
Hello,
Jordi
Audienzo
KC, the back-to-back defending champions, the side who won the title four times this decade under the stewardship of one man, Ambrose Martin, who now is hoping to lead the opposition to victory in the place where he's tasted success so many times in the past.
By now, we already found out
it's a great storyline.
Which two out of the 22 still
has a chance to get the trophy? We just need an entertaining 60 minutes of handball ahead. The Pap Laszlo Sport Arena here in Budapest is full to the brim. 12,500 fans.
So, ladies and gentlemen, before introducing the teams,
ready to enjoy this
final,
pinnacle of not only women's handball, but it has to be said, women's team sport. You cannot find anything like it around the world. When it comes to women's team sport, handball is truly the greatest. Now we're going to see two of the greatest sides in world handball at the moment go head to head. But first, we introduce the referees for today, and the honor of officiating this final goes to Poland's Joanna Bremer and Agnieszka Skowronek. They'll be taking charge of this game and hopefully won't be
please welcome the referees
noticing too much of them
final.
If they do that.
The whole tournament, they
job.
Are coming from Poland, Joanna Bremer and Agnieszka Skowronek.
Get a warm welcome from the crowd here, two very experienced
please
referees as well, as you'd expect
for the delegates
from
the European Handball Federation, from Bosnia and Herzegovina, Arianna Vujic, and from Slovakia, Janka
Stasova. As I mentioned
Stasova.
A few minutes ago, you have to wonder what's going through the heads of the two sets of players
and
right now.
The introduction.
The jury,
the
even though they've
finalists.
Been here and done that in the past, they cannot get
four
any
times
easier.
Winners
would not
of
like
the
to
Champions
get any
League.
Easier. There have to be
this
these nerves and the adrenaline
consecutive final.
Through their veins.
Will
and
they become
to get the
queens
for this.
Of Europe? Once again, ladies and gentlemen,
will not
this
suffice.
Is
you need to give absolutely everything. You need to fight, battle, and scrap for every ball. Noise like this reverberating around the arena, you cannot help
number
but
eight,
be pumped for this.
Hansen.
On the first for jurors, Carrie Hansen, the top scorer for them yesterday, Annabelle Hansen.
Number 12, I'm on the middle.
Back from her knee worries, she played yesterday a bit. Hopefully we see more of her today.
Number 15,
Amadine Lenoir, a fantastic game in goal in the semi-final.
Number 18,
Anita Gerber, so cool from the penalty line. Seen dictating things in the attack. Kimwada Amarine, the hero from the final last year. Veronica Christiansen, who just saw her sister pick up phones minutes ago. Susanna Tamari. Nika Krohn in her final international game for Bjørn.
Number 33,
Nika Krohn can become the all-time top scorer in the Women's EHF Final Four as well with one goal today. We may see even more from her as well. I would not be surprised to see that.
Trina Pitya
of last year's final.
Number 85, Kari
Molly
Grimsburg.
A dominant force of the Euro in December.
Head coach for Duty, Kari
Grimsburg. The incredibly experienced goalkeeper, one of three top goalkeepers in this side.
Devacharya.
By Gabor Dani, hoping to win his first title as a head
now
coach.
Now let's meet their opposition, already winners of the EHF Cup.
Our first
but that's
time
another level.
Finalists.
Last year they were here
Don.
And finished fourth.
No shortage of experience
the
in this team as well.
They are coming from Russia. Rostov,
they
Don.
Have never played in this stage. They have never reached the
and
final
player
before.
Number one, Galina Litvinova.
Russia led by Ambrose Martin, the man on your
number
screen
four,
there.
Yelena Slivinskaya.
The man hoping to dethrone
number
his
six, Yulia Maraharova.
In front of what is basically a
number
home
eight,
crowd.
Anna
Stasia Makeva. was sent off yesterday after 3 2-minute suspension. She's going to be important on both ends of the court. Fantastic left back and center back. She had a great game yesterday. And there's the woman of the moment, Anna Bekireva. She is the big question mark in this game. She can decide this entire match. If she's up to scratch today, if she's fully fit. And if she has an inspired game, it'll be very, very difficult to stop her. Anna Sedonkina had a wonderful game in the first half yesterday.
Number 63, Kristina Kozhoka.
And for Maisa Pessoa.
Number 84, Maisa Pessoa.
As well, against an incredible attacking lineup. And there is Maisa Pessoa, the woman who stopped her 3 years ago.
This is Victoria Borshenko.
Polina Kuznetsova,
the head coach for Rostov,
one of six
Martin
Russian internationals,
assisted
who reached the final of the Champ Euro 2018 back in December last year, and Ambrose Martin.
Everybody,
what's going through
please
his head as well, mixed emotions
for Women's EHF Champions League.
The important thing for him is that he's set up his side to do a job here. Nobody knows how to beat Jura better than the man who built them for success over the last 5-6 years. At the moment, all the players looking somewhat comfortable. There's Anna Sen looking down, perhaps a bit of nerves there, but nerves, as I said, are good. You need nerves, you need the adrenaline flowing through the veins as you get prepared to go into battle here. As we listen to the EHF anthem, it means we're just minutes away, in fact, less than 2 minutes away from getting this match underway. Smiles on the face of some of the players. Pure focus and concentration on others. Veronica Kristiansen with a big smile on her face. This is why she moved to Jura. This is why she moved to what she said is the biggest club in the world. Mika Grote as well in her final international game with this club before she moves to Odense in the summer. She always, always delivers at the final four. Need a bunch of these players to do the same today. Looking back for a scene. Capacity crowd here, 12,500
at
the Pavlovo Budapest Sport Arena are ready for showtime.
I kindly request
and as the players shake hands, exchange mementos, and then throw the balls into the crowd, it means that we're almost done with the formalities here. The final smiles exchanged between the two teams before they try and take the heads off each other. Quick look at the lineup here for Jury Adiento KC. Players to look around for and see if I can predict
now,
the lineup here. Ida Gurvitz on the left wing. Eduardo Amorim at left back, number 18. Sina Oftedal, number 15 at centre back. Probably will have Mika Krohn at right back, number 27. And Bernadette Bodhi on the wing with Amandine Lenoir perhaps in goal. And there is Gabor Dani in the centre of it all. As for Rostov Don, Maisa Pessoa or Anna Sedonkina will get the start. I would say Sedonkina will probably start here. On the left wing, Polina Kuznetsova, Lois Abing, number 10, and left back, Victoria Borshenko, number 99, will be playing in the centre. Anna Bekireva, number 13, at right back, and Yulia Manigarova, number 6, on the right wing, with Ksenia Makeva on the line for Jura. On the line, I would say it's going to be Kaori Brotsen. But you never know what these two teams have up their sleeve here for the final. Amandine Lenoir and Anna Sedonkina as the goalkeeper head-to-head here. Lenoir, the most valuable goalkeeper last season, as she lost in the final with Vardar. Here she is in the final with the quasi-home side. Two Dutch players there in the head-to-head, and Stine Oftedal, Anna Bekireva here, the other head-to-head. Two crucial, crucial players for their sides, and there's a look at the referees. One last time for Poland, Joanna Bremer and Agnieszka Stowronek. They will officiate today's game, and it looks to me like it will be Jura, the back-to-back defending champions, who will get us started here. Attacking from left to right on your screen in their traditional green and white kit. And defending on the right-hand side in the yellow and black shorts. will be Rostov-Don with Anna Seroikina in goal for them, as I predicted. Amandine Leonard starts in goal for Jurgen. Kari Bratsen
gets it on after her eight-goal performance.
Dino Lina, here he is. It's Chris O'Reilly here with you for the final of the Dino Group Women's EHF Final for 2019. They're back to back. Defending champions, Jurgen Audietto KC in possession with the first attack of the game. And Nika Krote on the right-back position comes into the centre now, lays it off to Amarim. Anna Sen comes right out on top of her. The referees allow play on. Amarim with the first shot and the first goal of the game. What a start for Jur. Borshenko out on the left-hand side looking for a quick pass. Second line coming in from the right wing, trying to trick this Jura defence at the very beginning. And the Jura defence are having none of it. Nice aggressive defending to start the game by that centre block of Amarim and Bratsen. It's Lois Abing in left back. Borshenko on the ball. Abing looking for the line, lays it off to Vekareva. Vekareva equalises with her first shot of the game, and any injury doubts about her laid to rest here with that first shot. Nice ball into the line, and it's 2-1 to Jura. And look at the faces of the players here. They mean business, and you'd expect nothing less. Excellent first wave attack after the goal there from Jura. Beautiful ball into the line by Croats. And Kari Bratsen picking up where she left off yesterday. The atmosphere in here is bonkers. I can barely hear myself think at the moment, but you'd expect nothing less from the women. The Women's EHF Champions League final. Abing looking for the line, lays it off to Borshenko. She cuts out to the right, ball out to the wing, eventually goes to Han, and it's 2 goals apiece. And it's Yulia Manigarova with the goal. Jura wasting no time. Amarim goes alone, and Duda Amarim makes it 3-2 with her second of the day. Goals galore here. We've barely played 2 minutes and 5 goals have been scored. Both sides pushing hard, really trying to gain an early upper hand here. Both sides dominated the first half against their semi-final opponents, hoping to do the same here, but they know it will not be easy. Abing to Borshenko. Ball over to Abing again, into the line. Beautiful pass and finished by Ksenia Makeva. Rhodes takes the ball up alone, goes through, and what's the call from the referee? It's a 2-minute suspension. Rhodes was grabbed around the neck by Makeva, and after she received the red card yesterday for a 3 2-minute suspension, she's got her first already today. Very high challenge on Kroats, who went through to take the shot, just a free throw given, but after just 3 minutes of play here, Jura have their first chance to play 6-on-5 in attack and build up a bit of an advantage. Kroats at right back, line switch with Bratsen. Oftedal makes her way into the centre, cuts out to the right-hand side. Sina Oftedal, ball out to Bernadette Bodie on the wing, saved by Seroikina. Did very well there, Anna Seroikina. She is great from the wings, it has to be said. She stands so, so tall. She waits and waits, and the shot wasn't terrible from Bodie, but in the one place, the goalkeeper loves to have a shot like that. And a good chance now for Rostov, not only to take the lead, but to kill the time here. Goalkeepers come off as they play 6-on-6 in attack with Anna Bekareva. Oh, and it just about makes its way in. Leonard had a hand to it, but there was enough pace in that shot by Anna Bekareva with her second goal of the game. And I said beforehand, she's going to have a big, big part to play in this game. She missed the main round and the first quarterfinal game after injuring her elbow. Needed a surgery. Wasn't predicted to be at 100% for this weekend, but she's giving it her all anyway. Oftedal with an attacker foul. No goal. And The Rostov bench call for calm. There's no need for them to rush things. Oftedal was celebrating a goal there. She didn't realize it was an attacker foul. And 30 seconds left on this 2-minute suspension. Rostov have killed it to perfection. No goals conceded, one goal scored. They'll try and hold on to this for as long as possible. Vejkareva. Arvin goes in as a second line player. Vejkareva's free. Ball into Mikheyeva. Saved by Lenord. Rhodes takes it down into Bratsin through the legs of the keeper. And we're all square at four goals apiece. Nice ball into the line too. It was Anna Sen, in fact, who was on the line. Mikheyeva serving the 2-minute suspension. Rhodes took it down, basketball style. Just needed to draw in the defender. As soon as she did that, dropped it off to Bratsin, who scored her second goal of the game. Borshenko. Vejkareva being marked one-on-one at the moment. Here she is on the ball. Lays it off to Abing. Off the crossbar. Into the hands of Anita Gurbitz. Kroats takes it away, looking for the outlet. In comes Veronica Christiansen. Off the underside of the crossbar, but not over the line. So how unfortunate is that for Christiansen? Brilliant play overall, but no luck. Borshenko into the line, and there's the lead for Rostov Don with Ksenia Mikheyeva. Woo! Barely 6 minutes of handball. We've already got 9 goals. Surely these two teams can't keep playing like that. I'm not sure if Rostov have the numbers to keep going for 60 minutes, but at the moment, they've got their lead. They're matching, outmatching Jura. Oftedal to Rhodes, cuts inside. Oftedal looking down the left-hand channel now. Amarine, Rhodes cuts in, looking for an outlet, but good defending down the center with Anna Sen and Mikheyeva, a formidable duo in that center block for Rostov. Oftedal. Rhodes goes from long range off the crossbar and off the back of the goalkeeper in over the line. She'll take it. Nika Rhodes, her first goal of the game. A fearsome shot off the crossbar, and that alone deserved the goal. And Seto Kina didn't know much about it, that it came off her back. Vejkareva, Abing, Kuznetsova, Abing, Vejkareva looks for the shot. Cuts out to the left-hand side. Arming now, she's got space for the shot. Referee's called a foul as she goes to the ground. Did well to find the gap between one and two. Christiansen just doing enough to concede the free throw and not the penalty. Borshenko. Arming. Borshenko down the left-hand side now. Abing looking to go one against one in the center. Vejkareva goes low through the legs of the keeper. And third goal of the game for Anna Vejkareva. She's on fire. Krode, ball out to the left wing is good. Recycled though. Krode again looking for space. Bounce shot for the far post, but Seto Kino was equal to it. And look at the smile on the face of Anna Vejkareva. Goes low with that one and just through the legs of the keeper. Oh, and she's delighted with herself. Oftedal. Amarim, good defending and almost stolen as well. Strong defending again. And Ksenia Mikheyeva looks over to coach Ambrose Martin for the nod of approval, which he gives. Oftedal, almost stolen. And the referees call the whistle just before it was picked up by the defense. Jura a tiny bit rattled at the moment by this Rostov defense. Bratsin coming around in the line switch, but there is contact with the face of Nika Rhodes. A sarcastic smile on the face of Anna Sen. She just gets a warning for that, a yellow card. It was a slap in the face, as light and as accidental as it was. She made contact. Oftedal. Amarim. Eduard Amarim over the top. Seto Kina looks for the outlet. Sen takes it over the halfway line. Out to the left to Abing. Anna Sen again. She's got space for the shot. Anna Sen straight at Lenord. But the referees called a foul. And maybe if she took it a moment earlier, Anna Sen, she would have had a free shot on goal. Took the contact instead. She makes her way off. replaced by Borshenko in the center. And Oftedal looking to mark Vierakareva one against one. Vierakareva commits the attacking foul. Leonard looks up, ball over to Amarim. She's held up, tries to get rid of it, stolen, but the referees call the free throw. And for the first time in 9.5 minutes, there's a momentary silence in the arena. But that silence disappears in a flash as Hoyer Jura rings around the arena. Groats into Amarim. Amarim looking for space. She's got space. Shot straight at the face of Sedokina. That was an accidental shot to the face, but Sedokina goes down heavily, as anyone would after taking a shot to the face from Amarim. Stuttergrand, well, you can see she didn't track it with her arms, but she's okay. That'll probably get redder as time goes on. Line switch with Bratzett. Amarim looking for it in the center. Here she is on the ball. Oftedal down the left-hand side. Amarim sends the defense down the river, but standing there was Vierakareva. She took the heavy attacker foul. Good defending and good covering there by Vierakareva. She is everywhere in these opening 10 minutes. 3 goals in attack during her shift in defense as well against players who are much, much bigger, but that doesn't matter one jot to her. Vierakareva, Borshenko, empty switch back into Borshenko. Vierakareva in the center now, tries to beat the defender. Ball over to Borshenko. She tries to wriggle her way free, but the defense looking very strong. A yellow card dished out to Groats. Abing, Borshenko. Borshenko over to Vierakareva. Anna Vierakareva goes alone. Shot is saved by Amarim, but a free throw given. There are no free shots being given here in this game. A yellow card now for Gabor Danyi for his complaints to the referees on the table. But as I was saying, not a single free shot given. There's always contact. The defense all over here. Even though there's been so many goals scored, Vierakareva, ball into the line, is dropped, and she was inside anyway. Makeva, ball goes to Leonard, over to Groats. She takes it over the halfway line. Nika Groats drifts out to the right, ball into the hands of Polina Kuznetsova. Kuznetsova on the fast break, she lays it off to Madagarova, and it's a 2-goal lead for the first time today. Rostov Don in the ascendancy here after 11 and a half minutes. Great steal and good support as well. It all came from that blind pass. Polina Kuznetsova was onto it like a flash, and in support came Yulia Manigarova. Oftedal goes one against one down the middle. She gets the shot off, and a penalty call this time for inside defending. Ambrose Martin is incensed. Anna Sen a bit more pensive in her approach to that decision. It doesn't look like she was inside to me. Ambrose Martin knows better as well. It's the yellow card shown to Ambrose Martin. And a yellow card for Ambrose. So both coaches being given a yellow card here in these opening stages. And stepping up for her first penalty of the day is Anita Gerbitz. Anna Sedokina steps out to 4 meters. Gerbitz fakes it once. Sedokina's going nowhere. Oh, beautiful lob over the head of Sedokina. Let's look at that one again. Sends Sedokina down and just spins it over her head. That is Queen Anita at her finest. Great wrist action from the left wing. The playmaker turned left wing in recent years. She and Amarim looking for their fifth title. 1-2 is no good. Picked up, or eventually, by Manigarova. Did well to fight the ball back into her hands. Abing decides to slow things down. Two line players in at the moment. Manigarova waiting. Ball over to Kuznetsova. Abing now. The ball goes the other way. Manigarova was being shoved into the line, and the referee saw it. Groats Ball out to the right wing. Bernadette Bodie. Oh, yes. How do you like that? Two drop shots over the head of the keeper. One from the penalty from the left wing, Gurmitz. One from the wing, from the right wing, Bernadette Bodie. Beautiful, deft finish. And it's not easy to do that against Anna Sedoykina. She's a very tall goalkeeper. But that's the level you're facing here in the Champions League final. Abing has a look around for the line, decides to go alone. And Lois Abing gets her first of the day. She's got one of the hardest shots in women's world handball. And she unleashed it there. Too many steps taken by Grote. Ball over the top to Managorova. She releases it. Chance here in the fast break. Kuznetsova goes alone and really should have passed that ball. Good defending, good covering by Stina Oftedal. After 14 minutes, having a chance to catch my breath for the first time, this game has flown by. 15 goals in 14 minutes of action. And it's everything you could want so far from the final of the Dalo Group Women's EHF Final Four. Anna Sen looking for her wing. Managorova comes into the backcourt. Sen lays it off. Space here for Abing. Sen looking a bit uncomfortable in the right back position. Abing from long range. Oh, and a bit of luck as the deflection comes off the defender's hands. And Lois Abing won't mind one bit. Second goal of the game for her. Two from three and looking a bit more confident in the backcourt. And Amarim, who came in as a second blocker, she was the one who sent it the wrong way. And there's a change in between the posts for Jura. Leynaud, after just one save from 10 attempts, is off. Kari Grimsbø is on. Amarim saved by Sedoykina. Rebound by Bodie into the hands of Makeva. And that could be a 2-minute suspension, I fear, for Eduarda Amarim. It is indeed. There wasn't too much in it, but in a situation like that, when a player is going onto a loose ball and cannot see the defender behind them, there's always a bit of a duty of care, it seems, for the person making the tackle. And Amarim perhaps trying to overcompensate for that missed shot seconds beforehand. Gets her first suspension. And a chance now for Ostov to extend their lead. They're a player up now in attack. Ball to Via Kareva. She lays it off to Managorova. Abing wide to the left. And it looks like the referees have a decision to make. And it's not a corner throw. That's where they were checking whether there was a touch there. No, I think there was a block there. I'd like to look at that one again. Kari Bratsen wasn't going to say anything anyway. Maisa Pessoa in front of me is claiming there was a block, and I think she's right. But Jura, with a bit of a let-off, now in possession as they try to kill the rest of this 2-minute suspension. Adametta Hansen, the Danish international, in the centre-back position for the moment. She plays it to Grote. Oftedal looking for the outlet. Oftedal to Grote. Oftedal looking to go one against one down the middle. Grote has a bit of space, doesn't fancy the shot though. Hand is up for passive play. Ball out to the left wing is cut out and out for a sideline ball. And now a timeout, the first time we've seen a timeout in this final. And it's taken by Jordi Audieto KC and their coach Gabor Dani. They're two goals down after 16 minutes. Let's listen in to the coaches.
Good. When they are up, same side, when second is up, please win, score without ball. This plays or the opposite side also. Don't stay, don't give a chance from dribbling, okay? Come on, more!
Come on! Come on!
Attention! If they play with six or with five, attention also the way outside. If they play the Norway, three over there, do the roster but not before. Let the pass, goal or no goal, somebody has to run really mana, go really fast to the middle, okay? Let's do it, go!
Yes!
The very precise tactics laid out by both coaches here. This is a real tactical battle, but at the moment, it's been all about pace. It's been all about guts and bravery from both of these sides. Hand is still up for passive play. Oftedal to Anna Mette Hansen. Hansen with the shot, but she's fouled, and looks like a yellow card to be given to Bekareva. No, it's to Manigarova. In fact, Yulia Manigarova gets the yellow card. And we continue. Hand is down. Passive play is over. 25 seconds left on Dürr's two-minute suspension. Oftedal looks for a way through. Ball over the top to Hansen. Out to the wing. Through the legs of the keeper. Bounced into the top corner. Anita Gurbitz with a beautiful finish. She makes it look so, so easy. Doesn't need a lot of pace. Doesn't need an angle. Just needs a shot on goal, and she'll do the rest. Suspension is over. Amarine back on court. Vekareva looks for the pass, but she was fouled. So Dürr doing very well to kill that suspension and actually score a goal as well. They've survived that threat. Milena Tazinova is in the centre-back position. There she is on the ball. Line switch. In comes Manigarova. Manigarova manhandled. And a two-minute suspension. She got a smack on the face from Anna Mette Hansen.
Player number eight, Anna Mette Hansen.
There's the first contact. Hansen waiting there, and I'm not sure if there was contact with the face, but it was a high challenge. Not too sure if there was too much wrong with that. She was inside, but not by much. Harsh call, I think, on Hansen. But she's off, and another chance now for Rostov to take advantage of an extra woman in attack. Vekareva to Poroshenko, who's on the right-hand side. Vekareva cuts out to the left, could have gone herself, plays it to her sister with a big lob over the top, but too much on it. Well covered by Kari Grimsbø. Fooled Kuznetsova there, and another wasted opportunity for Rostov with an extra player in attack. Just a bit too much on that one from Kuznetsova. And once again, Dürr will take their sweet time in attack now. Veronica Christiansen coming into the attack for the first time today. She's in the right back position, waiting for the pass. Here she is, Veronica Christiansen goes into contact and earns a free throw, as they want to do here. Still a minute left on the suspension to kill. Oftedal looking for the pass, and she's hauled down now. Bratsit will get us going again. Oftedal. Grote, hand is up for passive play. Nika Grote. Christiansen wasn't expecting that. She goes one against one. Tries to find Bratsit. Another foul. Bratsit to Grote. Nika Grote goes alone wide to the left. Sedokina picks it up, lays it off. Sen in the middle. Abing down the left-hand side. Anasen, there's space on the line. Oh, she didn't play it in. Too late. Anasen goes alone, though, and makes up for not passing before with a rocket of a shot. And her first goal of the game. And Grimsbø just a bit out of position there. You can see that's the corner she wanted to go for, but Grimsbø couldn't cover it. Two-minute suspension over, and it's Rostov in the lead by two yet again. Prot, Amarim, Eduarda Amarim to Oftedal, and the free throw given. Strong defending by Anasen. And now we're into the final 10 minutes of this first half. It's the final of the Women's EHF Champions League. And it's a cracker so far. Oftedal somehow finds a way through, and she earns a penalty for herself. Stina Oftedal with a classic Stina Oftedal move. Dancing in between the defenders. Loves going into contact, loves squeezing in between the biggest defenders. She is so, so good at that. And into the fray for the first time today, the penalty killer, Maissa Pessoa. the hero of the penalty shootout 3 years ago. She faces Anita Gerbets. Back in her line, Pessoa, but she goes down low, and Anita Gerbets goes high. No mistake from Anita Gerbets, and it's a one-goal game. She guessed the right way, Pessoa, but she went down low. And look at that celebration from Gerbets right into the face of Pessoa. In for the first time in attack is Bobrovnikova. She's on the ball now, waiting for it in the center. Bobrovnikova, Vekareva, saved by Grimsbø. Looking for the pass, gives it to Krohn. She takes it over the halfway line, taking her time. Now a bit of speed injected by Nika Krohn. Pass to Chris Janssen, it doesn't go to hands. Well covered though by Bernadette Bodhi. On the right wing, she cleans up the mess. And in comes Oftedal. Amarim for the moment in the center, so expect a line switch with Bratzit or Bodhi coming in from the wing. Here is Bodhi. Kroot, oh, pass to Bratzit, doesn't connect. It worked so well in the semi-final yesterday. This time, no telepathic connection. Vekareva cuts inside, ball across to Bobrovnikova, but she doesn't pass the ball. She decides to go alone. Attacker foul. Oftedal, Kroot, Amarim, Oftedal on the right, space for Bodhi. Bodhi, oh, somehow gets it past the hands of Sedojkina. She had it covered, but Bodhi just has enough pace on that shot. And after 22 minutes and 15 seconds, we are all square here in the gold medal match of the Dalo Group, a women's EHF Final Four. Rostov on 10, Djurd 10. Tazanova sending Anna Sen over to the right-hand side. Sen in on the line at the moment. Bobrovnikova in the center now. Vekareva, Tazanova, Bobrovnikova. Tazanova tries to find some space. Pass doesn't come on time, and well covered in defense by Veronica Christiansen. Flying around that defensive line. For Djurd, hand is now up for passive play. Vekareva looking for the pass, and too many steps taken. And the tide turning, perhaps. Djurd's defense looking stronger and stronger by the second. And in for the first time on the line is Karina Pentea. Susanna Tomori in at right back, number 23. So a few changes, keeping things fresh here, Gabor Danyi. Tomori, 1-2, ball out to Oftedal. She goes alone, and a penalty called. Inside defending, according to the referees. A real 50-50 call there. Let's look at that one again. And she was forced inside, the defender, but I think the two-minute suspension is a bit harsh there on top of the penalty. Galina Mehdieva comes in, the third-choice goalkeeper to face this penalty from Gerbets. Mehdieva, Gerbets, and Gerbets wastes no time whatsoever. He makes it look easy. Queen Anita with yet another penalty, and this time her fourth goal of the game gives Djurd a lead, 11-10. Three-goal run for the back-to-back defending champions. 6 minutes left now in the first half. And it's the starting lineup in the backcourt, back on court for Rostov now. Abing, Vekareva blocked down and over for a corner throw. And a tongue is out for Anna Vekareva. She enjoyed a lot of success in the opening 10 minutes. It's a different game now. Gonna have to come up with something new, but she's got plenty of tricks up her sleeve. Anna Vekareva. Hand is up for passive play now. Ball into the line is a beauty. Oh, yes! Yulia Managarova goes into the line from the right wing out of absolutely nowhere. And that's her third goal of the game, 11 each. Oh, Stina off the knoll. Leaves the defense for dead. Not even a touch on her. And that's her first goal of the game. Brilliant stuff from Stina Oftedal. And Jurt really starting to fire on all cylinders in attack now. And the crowd are up on their feet. All the Jurt fans up on their feet around here among the 12,500 fans here in Budapest. Ball across to Bekareva, eventually goes to Han, recycled out to the left-hand side. Borushenko, Abing, Bekareva tries to go one against one and she's held up. Amarine all over her. Hand up for passive play again. They're struggling a bit now in attack. Bekareva goes alone, blocked down again. Fast break opportunity. Grimsbo wants someone to play the ball to. Tomori is there waiting for her. She takes it over the halfway line. Amarim has a bit of space to run into now. Two players on top of her and a two-minute suspension. Unsurprisingly for Victoria Borushenko. Very heavy challenge from the side on Amarim. Around the neck as well. And for the next 2 minutes, it's Jurt. A woman up in attack and a goal up in the game. Oftedal. Tomori went a bit early there. Oftedal tries the other way. Ball into the line, through the legs of the keeper. Oh, and it's all going Jurt's way now. Eduarda Amarim in as the second line. It wasn't pretty, but it was damn effective. Looks like she got a hit in and around the eye as well as she took that shot. Look at the pure grit and determination from Amarim as she dragged her way past the defense to give her side a 13-11 lead. Bekareva in the center. Ball diving is no good and that's going to go over the sideline to Durabol. Shot into an empty net is saved by Seto Kino. Just gets back on time. Good idea from Gervis, but I'm not sure she knew that Seto Kino was making her way back, and in the end, a rather comfortable stop. Seto Kino goes off again. And in comes Kozokar on the left wing. And a timeout called for the first time today by Ambrose Martin. It's come at a good time as well. His Rostov side beginning to struggle a bit here. Let's see what he can change.
We have 40 seconds, we are one less. Vamos a, let's play this. Change the position. Change the position.
This is the key, and after we are one more advantage, we are one more. Okay, and you do it. Okay.
Hey, come on. And back, backs, go a little bit back and feel from behind.
Yes, most important defense. Yeah.
Back underway here. 2.5 minutes left in the first half of this final game of the Delo Group Women's EHF Final Four. Abing to Anna Sen, Bekareva, Abing, ball into the line is no good. An empty net for Eduarda Amarim to shoot into, and it goes over the line. And it's a three-goal lead. Duda Amarim, as soon as she got her hands on that ball, had eyes only for the goal. And that was a bit of reckless attacking there by Abing. Tried to force that one into the line, perhaps not remembering that they're a player down. 2 minute suspension is over. Rostov back to full strength. Sen looks for the option, but she's held up by Krina Pantea. Abing on the far side, but the shot by Vekareva is saved. Grimsbok having a hugely positive influence on the team since coming in. And that says everything about the strength and depth of this Giro side. In the semi-final yesterday, it was all about Amandine Lenoir. In the second half, Grimsbok did a fine job as well. Grimsbok coming in here after 15 minutes and helping Giro take control of this game. Tomori, Oftedal goes alone down the left-hand side, ball into the line, and a free throw eventually called by the referees. Pintea, Amorim looking for the option. Oftedal, Tomori blocked down, saved. Sedokina looks up for the pass. There's no outlet. Vekareva across to Abing. Lois Abing goes down the left-hand side through the legs of the keeper, but an attacking foul called. And a sarcastic smile on the face of Abing as she believes in something else. And well, the definition of an attacking foul becomes less clear by the day to me, but there were certainly no feet set on the ground by the defender on that occasion. Oftedal, Tomori, lays it off to Bodhi over the hands of Sedokina. And it's a four-goal game. And a two-minute suspension to boot for Kozhokar for the contact. I think the late hit on Tomori to add insult to injury. 10 seconds left to play in this first half. Four-goal game. Oh, how dearly. Rostov need a goal here, but it's not coming with that. 3 seconds left to play. Long-range shot over the top, and that is that for the first half here in the final of the Delo Group Women's EHF Final Four. Rostov Don came out on top early stages in what was an incredibly fast-paced start to the game. But slowly but surely, Giorgi Arrieto worked their way back into the game, took control of proceedings, and at the break, they hold a 15-11 lead. And at the moment, that is looking like a very, very solid lead. Of course, anything can happen here. We still have another 30 minutes of handball. And at times, Rostov have looked incredible. I'm sure Ambrose Martin has some more tricks up his sleeve. But Anna Vekareva, after having a blinding opening to the game, was relatively quiet afterwards. Ambrose Martin will have to figure out a way to open up the game and attack for her more. Consolidate that defense a bit more as well, because at times they really did have Jura worried. But the strength and depth and the brilliance throughout this Hungarian side proved to be the difference on the end of the first half. And they hold a four-goal lead at the break. Look at the stats here so far. 65% scoring from Jura, very, very strong. Saving percentages, not very impressive from either side. That may well improve in the second half. 4 2-minute suspensions for Rostov, 8 turnovers for them, and 6 technical faults. Well, there's the difference between the two sides. Eduard Amory and Anita Gerbitz on 4 goals apiece. Nika Hrod with her 1 goal makes her the all-time top scorer in the Women's EHF Final Four. Vekareva and Managarova with 3 goals apiece down the right-hand side, doing much of the damage for Rostov. But Vekareva in particular will need to find a new route to goal in the second half. Well, what a first half we've had here in Budapest. That was entertainment at its finest. And in about 10 minutes' time, I'll be back with you for live coverage of the second half here in Budapest. But until then, the halftime score, Rostov Don 11, Győr 15.
Is Hella Thompson, who achieved the bronze medal at the Women's EHF Euro 2018 in France as national team head coach of Dutch team. One big applause for Hella Thompson, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be right back.
Hello everyone and welcome back to the final of the De La Group Women's EHF Final Four, live from the Pap László Sport Arena in Budapest, Hungary. And at the break, it is the back-to-back defending champions Győri Arieto KC with a four-goal lead, 15-11, over the first-time finalists Rostov Don. And it was Rostov Don who really began the game the brighter in a really hectic start to the match where both sides were really giving it their all. They were going at a million miles an hour, and it was Rostov Don who looked like they had their opposition stumped for a while, but slowly but surely, Jura began to work their way back into the game, change their tactics up a bit, and in the end, it was Rostov who were looking stumped with some excellent defending from the Jura side and brilliant attacking led by the backcourt of Nika Kroth, Stina Oftedal, and Eduarda Amarim. The big question now is whether Rostov and their coach Ambrose Martin, who led Jura to four titles before moving over to Rostov last summer, have something up their sleeve, whether they can change this in any way. I have a feeling they will have something. They have a tactical genius at their helm. The big question is whether the players can deliver for them. Looks like we're just seconds away from getting this second half underway. And it will be the side trailing by four goals. Rostov Don attacking from left to right on your screens in the yellow jerseys and black shorts. And it will be Győri Arieto KC in their green and white, defending on the right-hand side. It's Chris O'Reilly with you for this final 30 minutes of the Women's EHF Champions League season. It's a four-goal game at the moment, but a lot can happen in 30 minutes of handball. Abing, Borshenko, Villakareva in the backcourt as they began. Rostov Don, Borshenko into Abing. Borshenko, Villakareva, ball to Abing is no good. It goes wide. And a good start for the side in the lead in defense. And Hoyra Djur rings around the arena. Oftedal comes into the center back position. Kari Bratzit back in on the line. Ball to Amarim. She breaks through. Shot saved. And a penalty called as Amarim goes down heavily. It was a fine save by Maisa Pessoa. Well, a late challenge from Villakareva caused Amarim to go down heavily, but she's up now. She looks okay. And it will be a penalty taken by Anita Gerbitz against Maisa Pessoa. Gerbitz against Pessoa. Oh, nicely finished. Dropped over the head of Pessoa in off the underside of the crossbar. Another perfect penalty by Gerbitz. And it's a five-goal game now. Bright start to the second half here for the defending champions. Exactly what they would have wanted. Rostov still with plenty of work to do. Villakareva receives it again. Looks for some space in the middle. Out to the wing. Recycled. Kuznetsova, she goes through along through the legs of the keeper. A fine goal there. Oftedal to Amarim. Amarim over the top to the right wing. Amarim through this time, and she gets her first goal of the second half. Two breakthroughs from the big Brazilian. Five goals today for her. And it's looking like it's going to be a tricky second half for Rostov unless they can change some things up here. Very strong start for the quasi-home side. Abing. Abing waiting for it as well in the left-back position. Villakareva tries to break through, uses her shoulder, and just a free throw given. Strong defending there by Veronica Christiansen. Borshenko. Manigarova being called into action. Voroshenko, Vekareva, hand is up for pass of play. Nice catch on the line, off the post though. Oh, it's not going their way here. A bit of luck on the Jura side. Kristiansen to Amarim. And they slow things down as Veronica Kristiansen makes way. Stina Oftedal comes in. And the atmosphere here as loud and electric as it was at the beginning of the game. 3 minutes gone in this second half. Oftedal, Kroat, Amarim loses it. Picked up by Vekareva, who's hit. And a 2 minute suspension to Duda Amarim, her second of the day. Anna Vekareva still down, looking in quite a bit of pain. I think it was an accidental hand which made contact with her face. Let's look at that one again. So it's picked up and, oh, a smack in the face, yeah. You have to see whether there was contact made with the eyes, and I fear so. Anna Vekareva still down, and it looks like the referees are going to review this one to see if there is cause for a red card to be given. And they say no, at 2 minutes is sufficient. And I think so as well. It was an accidental collision. Amarim, who had lost control of the ball, was just looking to grab it again. Thankfully, Anna Vekareva is back up on her feet and is happy to continue playing. And here she is on the ball. Voroshenko, Vekareva. Voroshenko to Abing. Vekareva cuts inside, looks to go alone. Abing down the left-hand side, held up by the defense, and the defense here by Jura is looking stone cold and solid. Vekareva tries to go one against one. She's held up by Kristiansen. Voroshenko has a go. Hand is up for pass to play. Abing save. Rebound out to the right, or the left wing rather. Ah, nice finish there. Well done there by Polina Kuznetsova. Picked up the rebound from the Grimsbo save. And danced around her defender to get her second goal of the game. Sends Bodhi one way. And drops that ball over the head of Grimsbo, who's not happy with her defender there. And it looks like Nora Merck is going to come in for the first time today. She's getting ready down beside me. Oftedal tries to go one against one. Bodhi. Hansen makes her way into 9 meters. Oftedal takes her time. Basketball style, looking for the option. Two line players waiting in there at the moment. Oftedal, oh, Stina Oftedal took her sweet, sweet time. Placed the shot past Maisa Pessoa. Big, big goal there for Oftedal. And such calm and measured play in the build-up as well. Killing that penalty nicely. And with 5 minutes played in the second half, Jura's lead is back up to 5. Vekareva tries to find the line, but she forced that one in. And there's really no space to play into at the moment. Free throw for Rostov. Out to the left wing, but it's cut out. Picked up by Grimsbo. And Gabor Danyi asks for calm. Oftedal over the Kroat, and in comes Nora Merck for the first time in this final. Played a few minutes in the semi-final yesterday and getting some prime court time here. 35 minutes in, introduced to the action for the first time. Kroat looking for Merck. Nora Merck goes in, ball into the line, is cut out. Chance here in the fast break. Quick ball over the top to Manigarova. She lays it off to Kuznetsova. That's going to be a penalty and a 2 minute suspension. Has to be. In fact, they're going to check the screen to see if it's anything more serious. Let's see what the referees decide. Kroat, first of all, trying to caused the attacker foul, but she was way too late there. And quite a dangerous play in the end, as Kuznetsova tried to take the shot. Let's see what the referees decide here from the review. And it's a red card. A red card to Nika Korot in her final international game for Jordi Arrieta. It ends far, far too soon. After 6 minutes of the second half. Well, that's what the video review is for, so they don't make rush decisions like that. And the referees agreeing in the end that that was dangerous enough to warrant a red card. Now a penalty. Abbing against Eva Kiss. Abbing puts it in the bottom right-hand corner. Four-goal game. And how big might this be? Groot, who over the years has been a crucial player in every single women's EHF final for Jura have played in, and even the one she played for Midtjylland in, the very first one. But this time, her final comes to a premature end. Hansen drifts down the left-hand side. She gives away the attacker foul. Pessoa has a look up. Rostov trying to push the pace here. They can smell blood. Rostov done. Abbing goes through. Saved by Grimsbo. And look at the face on Kari Grimsbo. She's not giving up easily here. Ambrose Martin calling for calm. He doesn't feel like rushing this one. There's still a minute left on the two-minute suspension, which came from the red card for Kroot. Ball into the line. Makeva through the legs of the keeper. Three-goal game. Ksenia Makeva with her third goal of the evening. Off comes Grimsbo. No goalkeeper at home for the moment as Jura tried to play 6-on-6 in attack. Line switch with Bratsen. She lays it off to Oftedal. Oftedal with a standing shot. Big moment for Jura coming out of that red card with a goal. Manigarova, for a moment, looked like she wanted to go all alone down the right wing. The side's against it. 10 seconds left on the suspension. Rostov, a woman up, ball out to the left wing. Dangerous. Recycled by Kuznetsova. Abbing, Bekareva almost stolen. Nice ball out to Manigarova. Saved! Gary Grimsbo with an incredible stop. How did she keep that one out? Manigarova with all the time in the world, but Kari Grimsbo flings the right arm and right leg up, and a combination of the two keep that shot out. Wonderful, wonderful stop from Grimsbo. And after that red card, you felt the momentum could shift, but saves like that, that's what the Final Four is made for. Burke, Amarim saved by Pessoa. Picked up, chance down the right wing. Manigarova is going all alone. Turns, needs to play the ball. Referees are happy she didn't take too long or take too many steps. Bekareva, foul on Manigarova. Voroshenko sets the set play in motion for Rostov in attack. Around comes Kuznetsova from the left wing. She tries to go one against one. Attacking foul called by the referee. Called by one referee at least. Kari Bratsen feeling the after effects of that. Let's look at it again. And yeah, well, she used her left arm and made contact with the face. Smart call from the referees. And we almost have 10 minutes of play behind us in this second half. Four goals is the lead. It remains as it was at halftime. Amarim saved, picked up by Amarim, but she was inside and the referee's call. A Rostov ball. It has to go back to Pessoa. She has a stern, stern look at the referee. She wanted to move the ball quickly. She's in no mood to be wasting time here, Maisa Pessoa. Abing in the center, Borshenko in the left back position for now. Line switch coming with Makeva, Bekareva, Borshenko. Bekareva has some space, decides against the shot, has a look around again, looking for some space. Bekareva, she gets the arm free, nice ball into the line, but the shot, oh, it looked like it was going wide, somehow stays in between the posts. It's a goal. Adjur looking to attack down the other end immediately, and in comes Anna Mette Hansen out of nowhere to bring up the 20-goal mark for Adjur and restore the 4-goal lead. First goal of the game for Hansen. And neither side in the mood for slowing down now. They feel, as I do and as the crowd do, that this is a vital portion of this match, setting the tone for what is yet to come. Bekareva leaves it behind. Christiansen picks it up. 1-2 with Bratzit. Veronica Christiansen tries to go alone. Veronica Christiansen finds the bottom right-hand corner. Gabor Danyi celebrates, arms aloft. 5 goals. Abing held up by Bratzit. Bekareva across to Borshenko. Borshenko to Bekareva. Empty switch on the right-hand side. Bekareva in the center now, looking to go one against one. She's free. Doesn't fancy the shot, though. Passes out to Abing, and the referee's just called the free throw. I feel if Bekareva went through there, she probably could have drawn a penalty from the referees. Decided to pass, however. And it's just a free throw. 12 minutes gone. Second half. The gold medal match of the Dalo Group Women's EHF Final Four. And it's the champions. Adjur up by 5. Bekareva, ball into the line is a beauty. Oh, yet again. The combination at the moment between Ksenia Makeva and Bekareva proving very, very fruitful. 21-17. Amarim comes in for Hansen. Oftedal on the left-hand side. Now Amarim looks to go one against one in the center. Ball into the line. Kari Bratzit. Kari Bratzit scores. And neither side able to stop the other in defense at the moment. Third goal of the game for Bratzit. She's got a perfect 11 goals from 11 shots so far this weekend. The girl who joined from Vipers at the beginning of this season, proving perfect from the line in this Final Four. Kuznetsova comes in as a second line player from the left wing. Abing, Bekareva looked to go low, decided against it. Bekareva waiting in the right, ball out to the wing. Manigarova sneaks that one in past Grimsbø. And as I said, neither side able to stop the other in attack at the moment, trading goal for goal. Grimsbø was close, but not close enough. Line switch with Bratzit. Merck, Nora Merck goes down the right. Receives it again from Bodie. Merck into the line, gets a bit of luck again, bounces back into her hands, and now she's held up. Trying to force that one into the line a bit early, perhaps. Oftedal goes alone and it's wide. Pessoa looks for the outlet, gives it to Abing. Tazanova now waiting in the right-hand side. Bobrovnikova in the center, asking Abing to slow things down as Bekareva comes back in at right back. We're almost into the final quarter here. Just over 15 minutes left to play in this final. Manigarova, Bekareva, Anna Bekareva, ball into the line to Anna Sem, but it's wide to the left. The penalty called. 7-meter penalty. I think it was inside defending by Stine Oftedal. Anna Sen definitely had a clean route on goal, but yeah, inside defending. No argument there. And in comes Ava Kiss to face the penalty. We've had no luck from the penalty line, the keepers yet so far today. And Abing steps back to about 8 metres for this penalty. One slow fake and then fires it in to the top left-hand corner. And with 15 minutes left on the clock, it is a three-goal game. Karina Pintea waiting to come on right in front of me. But at the moment, Carrie Bratzett doing a fine job on the line. Oftedal into Bratzett. She's taken down by about three different players and she stays down. Contact with the head as well. Just get one player behind her, two in front of her, trying to take her down, eventually do take her down. But just the free throw called. Oftedal, basketball style, looking for an option. Nora Merck's there, dances around to the right, lays it off to Bodie. Merck again, looks to go one against one, and she's held up by McEva. Oftedal, down the left-hand side, nice ball out to the wing. Saved by Pessoa and out over the sideline. Berger ball and Gerbitz. Rushing that shot a bit, but Pessoa stayed so calm and stayed so strong. Gave for the near post, but Gerbitz had no interest in it. Amarim out to Gerbitz, and this time it's a goalkeeper ball. Ball over to Manigarova. Yulia Manigarova looking for the pass, but it's stolen by Gerbitz. Oh, what a steal! What hustle! And down the other end, Oftedal tries to go alone. She goes to ground. Free throw called. But what else? Hide yourself, Manigarova, if you don't want the 2 minute suspension. It looks like just a free throw. Gerbitz looking for more. Amarim looking for more. The referees are having none of it. But look at that steal from Anita Gerbitz. Hustling back after giving away the ball moments before. Oftedal, Tamori in at right back now. Amarim has a go. Tamori almost loses it. Bodie to Tamori. Amarim cuts out to the right-hand side. Saved by Pessoa, but a free throw called. As has often been the case today. And Maisa Pessoa gets up very, very slowly. Looking in a bit of pain. She's staying in goal, for the moment at least. I don't know if it was an awkward twinge as she slid to save that shot, but she stays between the posts for now. Pintea tries to go through, but an attacker foul called against her. Pessoa with plenty of speed in those legs now. Gabor Danyi is bewildered by the decision. And Pintea looked like she was using her shoulder to try and bustle her way through there. That's what the referees saw. Obrovnikova on the left back position now. Obrovnikova, Abing, Beakirova. Abing, Beakirova in the center now. Looking to go one against one, but that shot is over the top. Grimsba lays it off to Oftedal. Christiansen waiting on the left-hand side. Oftedal looks to go one against one, cuts inside. Ball across to Tamori. Tamori goes through and earns herself a penalty. Nice ball back across by Oftedal. Saw there was nothing doing on the left and on her way down. Managed to release that ball onto the oncoming Susanna Tamori. Great pass across. And now a penalty. Anita Gerbitz, yet again, facing Maisa Pessoa. From 7 metres, Pessoa stays back in her line. one fake. And sends Pessoa the wrong way. Gurbit scores yet again. 23-19. And you can cut tension with a knife here right now. The women's EHF Final Four never fails to deliver. Vea Kareva hauled down by Hansen. Bobrovnikova, Abing, Vea Kareva dances one way. A very heavy challenge by Chris Janssen. Maybe a bit too aggressive. I think she realizes that as well, but the referees just call a free throw. Kuznetsova comes in from the left wing. Two lines now for Rostov. Hand is up for passive play. Vea Kareva, Abing, Lois Abing fires that one in off the underside of the crossbar from long range. I'd like to see the speedometer in that one. During the Euro in December, she was whipping shots in over 100 kilometers an hour. I wouldn't be surprised if it was a similar speed there, her fifth of the day. That brings up the 20-goal mark for Rostov. And it's a three-goal game again. Amorim looks to go one against one. And oh, trickles that one in. And she makes her way off the court. Just did enough to beat Maisa Pessoa. Pessoa had it covered, but Amorim just beat her. 24-20, 10 minutes left to play. Kuznetsova comes in as a second line again. It's worked the last few times. They try it again. Abing, Bobrovnikova, Bekareva wants it, almost run into each other. Manigarova now has a look. She beats the defender, and I think it's going to be just a timeout because the buzzer was pressed just as Manigarova had the beating of her defender. That was an unfortunately timed timeout. Nevertheless, just under 10 minutes left to play. Let's listen in to the coaches.
One more. I hope. Okay. One more. Yes. Let's play this ball situation here. I take Paulina, take you, and then outside. Attention. When I score, but now they won. If they are six, if yes. But, when run, Paulina or Mana, run when she has the ball. And don't pass the ball because if not, you receive the press. Go.
Is coming in front of Vicky. She can keep it her, no problem. To pass to pivot cover when Abing will coming. Cover and help to goalkeeper also, okay? And everything is second chance. Both side, the wing player has to more one by one. Ready?
So it was indeed a 2-minute suspension for Anita Gurbitz for that challenge on Manigarova. The referees decided that regardless of the fact that a timeout was called and it was still worthy of a suspension as it happened while the play was ongoing. Rostov in attack, Makeva, Vekareva held up immediately, strong defending by Chris Janssen, not giving Vekareva any room to breathe at the moment. Manigarova looking to help out Abing. Vea Kareva, she's got space, ball over the top. Oh, nice drop over the head of Grimsba. Bobrovnikova with a deft finish for her first goal of the day. And yet again, it's a three-goal game. This second half has seen the lead switch between three and four goals over and over and over again. But Rostov unable to get within two just yet. No goalkeeper at home for Jura playing 6-on-6 in attack. They have to be careful with the ball here or there's an empty net behind them. Oftedal on the right-hand side. Amorim gives it to Tomori. Amorim cuts out to the left. Ball to nobody. Already went off there, Fodor. He was careful about not leaving her goalkeeper stranded on the sideline. But in the end, it meant they just gave the ball away to Rostov. 36 seconds left on this suspension. Golden opportunity for Rostov to cut the deficit to two. Bobrovnik over into the line, off the crossbar. No foul. Chris Jansen takes her sweet time, has a look around, makes sure there's nothing dangerous behind her. A great take by Makeva, but she couldn't put it away. Well, look at that reaction. He has to applaud the effort, and that is incredible coaching as well. Despite the situation, he can still applaud his players. Oh, it's yet again a squeaky goal from Amarim. She just somehow manages to find a way through over and over again. Almost stolen there from Manikarova. Amarim almost gets the steal after scoring the goal. Seven for her. She just always comes up with the goods, Eduarda Amarim. And that time off the inside of Pessoa's left heel. Abing, Bobrovnikova, hand up for passive play. Fea Kareva has a look around. Can she come up with something here? Ball to nobody. Free throw given. Hand is up for passive play. And a bit of dispute about where the free throw should be taken. Makeva finally gets the warning. Fea Kareva drifts inside into Makeva, but it drops. And a free throw given. Oftedal fine with the decision. Fea Kareva looks around, plays it out to Manigarova, out to the left-hand side, but stolen. Oh, what a steal by Bodie. How important is that? Bernadette Bodie, look at the smile on her face. She's having a stormer out on the right wing. The only right wing in the squad today after Yana Knedlikova was injured in the semi-final yesterday. Oftedal to Amarim. Oftedal plays it out to the wing. Spin saved. Pessoa has a look up. Fine save by Pessoa. Fea Kareva takes it over the halfway line. Abing now in the center, goes in, nice ball over to Bobrovnikova, out to the wing, off the crossbar, picked up by Manigarova, but she hit it over the end line. And it's a dure ball, and I think that was the right call as well, but a 2-minute suspension handed out in the meantime to Susanna Tomori, I believe. Well, that's twice now, a shot off the crossbar. These golden, golden opportunities gone to waste. And he doesn't applaud that one. Just over 5 minutes left to play. Another 2-minute suspension for Jure to deal with here. Chris Jansen in the center in attack now. He goes out to the left-hand side. Amarim looks to go one against one. Eduard Amarim is held up. Strong defending by Manigarova. Oftedal, basketball style, looks to go. Oh, ball into the line. To Pintea, eventually gets her hands on it. And a free throw given. Oftedal out to the right this time. Ball to the wing is no good. Pessoa takes it away. Well, she'd like to take it away, eventually gets her hands on it. Ball over. Sen in the center. Bea Kareva. Manigarova to Bea Kareva again. Anna Sen looks to push the pace. Marika Kareva is held up by Amarim, who goes down low. Make sure it's a safe challenge. 37 seconds left on the suspension. Manigarova, Abing. Bea Kareva back to Abing. No, why did she pass that? It doesn't matter. I don't know why she passed it, but Yulia Manigarova was still there to put it away. Abing, well, she didn't have the momentum in her legs. In the end, it proved to be the right decision. 3-goal game 9 seconds left on the suspension. Fajr, they're up by three with 3.5 minutes left on the clock. Chris Jansen tries to bustle her way through. She draws the foul and a 2 minute suspension for Ksenia Makeyeva. It's Anna Sen, in fact, who's making her way off. Her second suspension of the game. And yet again, it's Anita Gerbitz from 7 meters, this time against Anna Sedokina. Fakes it once, Gerbitz, and saves Sedokina! Out over the sideline. Finally, Anita Gerbitz is stopped from the 7 meter line. 3 goals remains the lead. The possession remains in Jura's hands. And there's just over 3 minutes left. Still time for something to change here. But at the moment, the defending champions from Hungary looking pretty good. Ball out to Bodie. Oh, she leaves it behind herself. Through her legs. She's had a fantastic game all day, Bodie. But this time, perhaps thinking about the shot before she got her hands on the ball. Maybe the pressure getting to her. Manigarova, Kavea Kareva, Abing in the middle, and there's a timeout called, and the final timeout of the game for Rostov Don and Ambrose Martin. Just under 3 minutes left to play. What else has he got up his sleeve? Let's listen in to the two coaches now.
Five for you. No, Nastalva. Esmiena or Denmark?
Denmark.
Yes, but good one Denmark. By one. Denmark. Good, don't pass before. Good one by one on the number three. And you run in the right moment.
Okay.
And you come and change here. Okay. Hey. The center, of here.
Inside the second, we don't want this dribbling. Okay, if you will see the second player has a problem, go, come up and one pass and start 2x2. Okay, and girls, opposite side wing, go run into without ball. Okay, come on.
Back underway here. Final timeout for Rostov has been and gone. Abing. To Manigarova, lays it off and behind the back shot and a foul called, but just a free throw for Bobrovnikova. The time ticks away. No goalkeeper at home for Rostov. Vyakareva plays it inside, tries to get her team moving. The hand is up for passive play. They can't afford to waste any more time now. It's a high challenge. They continue. Vyakareva tries to wriggle her way around, but Anna Mette Hansen is having none of it. Vyakareva doesn't fancy the shot, but who does fancy the shot? Abing does. Lois Abing with another rocket from the backcourt. And it looks like the delegate has spotted an illegal substitution. Ambrose Martin says nothing doing. I don't know if we'll need a video replay to see that exactly. Ambrose Martin is very certain of himself. This could be big as well, as our Bosnian delegate decides to look at the replay here. A legal substitution is, I believe, the call. And she is saying, I think she's saying it's a 2 minute suspension. Still discussion, still arguments coming from Ambrose Martin. Only the delegate can know for sure. She saw the replay. Still argument coming from Martin. And this could be huge, not only would there be one fewer player on the court, but it depends which player that is. Was it Bea Kareva? A 2-minute suspension for an illegal substitution. But who has it been assigned to? That is my question at this very moment. The drama unending. And was it Pessoa who came off? It was Pessoa who came on too early. So her game is over. And for the next 17 seconds, Rostov are down to four women on the court. The juror with a 2-goal lead now, just looking to kill as much time as possible and look for an easy shooting situation. Pintea comes around on the line switch. Christiansen looking for an outlet. Off the doll, picks it up. The hand is up for passive play. Ball out to the left wing. To Gerbet, saved. Rebound. Stays in Rostov's possession. Chance now on the fast break. They need a goal here. Just over a minute left. Ball over the top to Manigarova. Bea Kareva joins the attack. Yulia Manigarova has a look. Bea Kareva, ball over the top. They cannot afford to waste any time there. Almost 7 minutes since Jura last scored. Nika Krode can barely look on. Abing. Bea Kareva, she's through. Penalty. And she goes down and looks in serious pain as well. Timeout called as well. The medics are coming on. And she does not look comfortable at all. Was it a shoulder? Was it the elbow? The elbow, or it looks like the shoulder, the right shoulder, but she's up now, thankfully. And the referee is with another video review to see the extent of this challenge. And it looks actually like Bea Kareva has gone off holding her left elbow, the elbow which she had surgery on at the beginning of this year. And I hope for her sake that it is nothing too serious. There is 37 seconds left on the clock. Lois Abing with the penalty, but first a decision, a 2-minute suspension to Eduarda Amorim. That's her third and final suspension of the game. She wouldn't be able to come on anyway, but should we go to extra time, she will not be available. She receives her red card, the second red card of the game for Jura. Nika Krode received one at the beginning of the second half, a direct red card. This one, the third 2-minute suspension. But more importantly right now is Abing from the penalty line has a chance to make it a 1-goal game. Abing takes it once, twice, finds the bottom right hand corner, and it's a 1-goal game, 25-24 to Jura. And we're into the final 30 seconds. Oftedal to Christiansen. Oftedal, basketball style, trying not to lose the ball here. And a timeout called by Gábor Danyi. And I think just in the nick of time as well. There may have been an attacker foul had he not called that timeout. 17 seconds left on the clock. Let's listen in to the two coaches.
Okay, Kina is out. Kari is also out. Tine, AM, Vicky, you and you, okay, and girls, the keys, move without ball, no pass, take it and make a foul, okay, no, no, no shoot, no shoot, come on.
Okay, but help me, help me each other.
The instructions are clear from Gábor Danyi, no shot. No pass, dribble the ball, draw the foul. That's how they will see out the remainder of this game. The remaining 17 seconds of normal time in the gold medal match of the Dalo Group Women's EHF Final Four. off to Dahl, dribbles down the right hand side, takes her steps, shoots wide to the left. There's 10 seconds left on the clock, no timeouts left. 7 seconds, ball out to the left hand side. Lois Abing, Bea Kareva, out to Managarova. Bea Kareva, she has to shoot, ball out, the time is over. And the champions for the third year in a row, Hungary's Győri Arieto KC are the champions of the Dilo Group Women's EHF Final Four. They had one last shot, but nobody backed themselves to take it. Nobody took the shot before the final buzzer went. And it's Győr, the pride of Hungary, who are the champions of Europe yet again. And it's Kari Grimsbo with the final save. Whether it's before or after the time, it matters not now. What a performance from her and from the entirety of this Jura team. What an incredible match. Gone down right to the wire. Just like every single year, it seems, at this Women's EHF Final Four. The final never fails to deliver a stunning match. You've got a feel for Rostov-Don. They fought all the way. They gave themselves the opportunity to draw level before the end. This time, no extra time was needed. Verger, they survived. I just look at the smile. The smiles. And in contrast to despair for Ambrose Martin and his girls, who did so, so well, reaching their very first Women's EHF Champions League final. They pushed the queens of European handball all the way. Anna Bea Kareva had a stunning start to the game, had to show every single trick in her puck in this second half. But it was not enough this time. It's a fifth title for Anita Gerbitz and Eduarda Amarim. A fifth title for Győri Arieto KC. Bravo, says Gábor Dányi to Kari Bratzett, who was phenomenal this week. Perfect shooting all weekend long from her. What a series of wonderful performances throughout this team. And you have to give it to Rostov-Don. You have to hand it to them. What a brave, brave performance that was. They knew they were in for a tough one. They did not have as deep a squad as Jura yet. They battled all the way. They seemed to be the side with the momentum at the end of the game. If they had a couple of more minutes, it may have been a different case. So many talking points from this match. But at the end of it, the only thing that matters is that the ladies in green and white are the champions yet again for the fifth time, the third year in a row. Jura are the queens of European club handball. And the 12,500 capacity crowd here at Pap Laszlo Sport Arena in Budapest, Hungary. The majority of which is filled with green and white. Really, really enjoyed that. It's not a final unless it goes down to the wire in the Dalo Group Women's EHF Final Four. And so it proves to be yet again. What a day, what a day. Two games which went down to the wire. First of all, it began with Vipers holding on for a one goal victory to win bronze against Metz. And now Jure holding on to pick up their third consecutive title and the now traditional dance at the end of it all. It's a sight I'm sure all of these Jura fans will never get sick of seeing. And Veronica Christiansen there, who has won her very first title. It's her first season with the club. She put in one hell of a shift in defense, taking care of Anna Vyacheva for the vast majority of the game. Poor Anna Sen, and that's the unfortunate thing about these occasions, particularly when it's so, so close, at the side who falls just short become inconsolable. And it's sure a celebrate. As I look through some of the stats, and Anita Gerbitz, 6 goals for her, 5 of them from the penalty line, almost perfect from the penalty line, and the one she missed in the end didn't matter. 7 goals for Eduarda Amorim. Year after year, Eduarda Amorim delivers when it matters most. It's not always the prettiest, but it sure is effective. And she's done it yet again. Also, I have to say the goalkeepers, and Kari Grimsbo in particular today, came on after 15 minutes after Leinart didn't have the brightest of starts, which wasn't necessarily her fault. The game was just at such a frantic pace. Defense was non-existent. But Grimsbo, she stepped up and she put in a player of the match performance. She was strong in the second half yesterday, but in the final today, she was incredible. And Amorim yet again, the hero, 7 goals for her. Stina Oftedal as well, who led the attack so, so well. 3 goals for her, popping up with incredible shots when it mattered most, earning penalties, doing anything that was required, and at the key moments, just keeping her side calm in attack. Kari Bradset, a perfect 3 from 3 today, 8 from 8 yesterday. 100% shooting from the Norwegian line player, also in her very first season with this club. As for Rostov Don, 7 goals from 12 attempts. For Loa Sabing, Anna Vyacheva, 3 from 8. She wasn't feeling it from shooting today after the first 10 minutes, but she created a plethora of opportunities for her teammates. She was so influential. And you have to feel for her. Yulia Manigarova as well, 5 from 6 from the right wing. Ksenia Makeva collecting some incredible passes from the line. 5 goals for her as well. And Anna Sedokina with some crucial saves towards the end, and also in the semi-final yesterday on Maisa Pessoa. A sour ending for her after a very solid second half. A look at the stats here, 31% saving rate. Better for Rostov than it was for Jura. Turnovers, 15 to 14. It wasn't the prettiest in terms of clean attacks. A lot of technical errors, a lot of turnovers, but I was down to some incredible defending from both sides. Eduarda Amorim and Abing, 7 goals apiece. Gerbitz with 6. And just look at that. Despite not scoring for the final 7 minutes of the game, Jura picked up the victory. They survived the comeback. And now I'll take a break for a moment. Catch my breath as you enjoy the beginning of this closing ceremony. So the trophy is on the stage, and now it's time to begin it.
To be honest, we are still
the winner's ceremony
after such an exciting last seconds of the final, and another great weekend to celebrate women's club handball.
I just want to say thank you to all the fans who were here during the weekend, because the atmosphere that you've created is just outstanding. Thank you so much for these wonderful moments. Thank you so much for these wonderful memories. You are the best fans in the whole world.
And that's true.
Very true words about the fans. An incredible atmosphere over these 2 days in this true hub of women's club handball. And there are a few better sites in women's sport than the 12,500 fans crammed into this arena. An incredible performance throughout. But being introduced now is Metz, who finished fourth in their very first appearance at the Delo Group Women's EHF Final Four. They will
like to ask you to
not be happy with their weekend right now, but have a lot to look back on. A very, very encouraging second half performance in the semi-final yesterday, and a true battling performance as well today. Not showing their truest of potentials, but teams don't always do that in their first trip to Budapest, and I'm fairly certain they will be back with a bang sooner rather than later.
The second best team in Europe and the Champions League
Here in the Delo Group Women's EHF Final Four.
Also a shout out, of course, to Vipers Kristiansand, our bronze medalist. But now for our silver medalist, Rostov Don. And this has got to be the most painful walk and ceremony of their professional lives. Something they've been working on throughout the years. After losing in the quarterfinal back in 2016, many people felt that Rostov were one of the favorites for the title the following season. That season saw them crash out in the group matches. A huge surprise to everyone, but they rebuilt the following season, 2017-2018. They made it all the way to Budapest for the first time and disappointed themselves with a 25-19 semi-final loss to Vardar. They vowed to be back. They vowed to be better, but stronger and more focused this time around. And that's exactly what they were. They had a brilliant first half against Metz, where they showed a lot of courage and mental strength to survive the comeback. And then today, despite going down, despite staying down by three or four goals consistently throughout the second half, they did not give up, not for 1 second. They kept pushing on. They managed to close the gap down to one goal, and they had their opportunity in the final attack, but it did not work out. And awarding the silver medals is EHF President Mikhail Viderer and EHF Vice President Predrag Boskovic. The tears, of course, still on the face of many of the players, but they have an awful lot to be proud of this weekend. Two fine performances. They've pushed the defending champions all the way, and it will not be their last rodeo at this level. Ambrose Martin has done wonders all season with this team, who have suffered from injuries throughout the season. He's had to reshuffle his team over and over again. They hit top form in the quarterfinal to defeat FTC, a side that many people expected to reach Budapest this year, but they completely outshone them to get to Budapest yet again. And Ambrose Martin almost masterminded the greatest of victories over his former side. It was not to be this time around. But I have a strong feeling that Rostov Don and Ambrose Martin are going nowhere soon. They'll be back. I have to give a lot of credit to their players, and in particular, Anavea Kareva, I feel, deserves an awful lot of credit. She was out for the majority of this second half of the season after her elbow injury and surgery upon it. Ambrose Martin said she would not be at full fitness yet. She played the vast majority of this game. She did not have any intention of sitting on the bench and watching the game go by. She kept fighting right until the end, and she deserves so much credit for her performance, as do so many of these players. Not the deepest of squads, that may change in the near future, but those who are out there today and in the semi-final yesterday have a lot to be proud of. And as you can see, the traveling Rostov fans who have stayed to support them and celebrate them are very proud of them. It's tough now, but it will dawn on them at some point just how good their achievement is of reaching the final of this season's Women's EHF Champions League.
Scoring 10 times in the bronze medal game, Lin.
And now it's time to award the top scorer of this season's Women's EHF Champions League. All she needed was two goals to take the crown in the bronze medal game today. She ended up scoring 10, by far and away the top scorer in this season's competition, Lin Yrum-Sulland. Wonderful performance from her, and an added bonus as well to the bronze medal won by Vipers Kristiansand today. A very nice end to what began as a tough weekend for Kristiansand. 89 goals for Lin Sulland, who's been at this level before, a former Jura player, of course. She also won the Champions League back in 2011 with Larvik. She said after the game that she just loves playing with these girls. She was so proud of them. She believed in them. And when she stepped up to take that match-winning penalty, she said those are the moments that she lives for. She wants to take on that pressure. And she certainly did that today. So congratulations to Sulland. And now time to introduce the MVP of the championship. And it's Kari Alvik Grimsbø. Jordi Audieto, KC goalkeeper. Player of the match performance today. A fine second half yesterday as well. And she receives the MVP of the weekend. That brings her son onto stage as well. It's not the first time she's stood up in front of this crowd and taken their plaudits. She's been there throughout the years as they picked up these titles. It all began when she was brought in as a mid-season replacement. The thinking originally was she was just going to fill in for a few months. But here she is, a key part of the squad. And Kari Grimsbø picks up the tournament MVP to go with the shiny gold medal she'll be collecting in a few minutes' time. Congratulations to Kari Grimsbø. With that, it is time to welcome on the champions for the third time in a row, for the fifth time of all time. The pride of Hungary, the queens of European club handball, Jordi Audieto, KC.
The winners of the Delo Group Women's EHF Final for 2019 are...
And the vast majority of the 12,000 capacity crowd here rise to their feet one more time to welcome their heroes back onto court. A phenomenal weekend, capping off an incredible season overall. Unbeaten throughout, just two drawn games in the main round, but besides that, a perfect record and deserving champions of this year's Delo Group Women's EHF Final Four. And they come in with their pre-arranged champions t-shirts. You'd be foolish not to when you're Jura, not to have this prepared. But it was not easy. It was not easy by any stretch. There will be some emotional players here, not only because of the victory, but it's the end of the road with this club for some players, such as Mika Kroats, who will be moving on to Odense over the summer. Also, Krina Pentea, who was brought in
once again, the
in January after an incredible EHF Euro. She will be moving to CSM Bucharest, as will the first awardee of a medal, Nora Merck. She too will be off to Bucharest in the summer.
So there'll be some changes within the squad, but the winning mentality will remain.
Kari Bratzed receives her medal, and what a weekend she's had. I cannot stress that enough. 11 goals from 11 shots from Bratzed in her first season, in her first Women's EHF Final Four, and his first Women's EHF Final Four. Gabor Dany is coach. Veronica Christiansen receiving her first gold medal as well after her move from Mitchelland last season. And Anita Gerbitz, well, it's not her first, it's her fifth. And it's also the fifth with a woman waiting to receive hers in just a moment. Eduarda Amarin. And the great thing about this squad is that every single player contributes. Every single court player scored a goal in the semi-final yesterday. And although they did not all play today, the vast majority of them did. And you have to hand it to Gabor Dany as well. He believes so much in all of these players. He rotates his squad throughout the game. He does not allow any player to get tired. Although a couple of players such as Stina Oftedal and Eduarda Amarin played the vast majority of the game. Also Anita Gerbitz today, who is defying the years, putting in some fine performances out in the wing. But it's difficult to single out players in a team like this, a team full of superstars who have managed to live up to expectations. As we know, it is not that simple. As we see in the men's side, at the sides where you expect to see the champions emerge based on the players. It doesn't happen. But here in the women's side, for the third year in a row, the pride of Hungary, the queens of European club handball, the champions of the Delo Group Women's EHF Final Four 2019, Juri Audieto Casey. And Anita Gerbitz lifts the trophy for the fifth time. And it's a sight that these players will never grow tired of seeing. What a way to end an incredible weekend and an incredible season of the Women's EHF Champions League. And I think there are no better pictures to leave you with than this. And for me, Chris O'Reilly, to say goodbye for now. I'll try and grab a word with one of the winning players afterwards. But from the commentary side, from me, Chris O'Reilly, and everyone here on the EHF TV team, it's goodbye for now. I hope you enjoy this weekend. I certainly did. Thank you for joining us, and hope to hear from you very, very soon. But until then, take care of yourselves, and goodbye.
Amazing. Champions League 2018-2019 and the proud winners of the Delo Group Women's EHF Final for 2019. to the winners. Congratulations to all the teams who participated. Thank you, girls, for making this experience again unforgettable. Thank you for the great matches. Thank you for the great moments. Thank you for putting your hearts into it. We love you all very much. And congratulations. It's now time for celebration. I've tried to cut these corners, try to take the easy way. I kept on falling short. After this amazing weekend, we have so many memories to take home. We have so many beautiful moments to treasure. And I'm sure it's unforgettable for these great players on court.
So we're here at Kari Grimsbø, champion for the third year in a row and MVP of the weekend. The third year in a row on top of that podium, but I can tell by the smile on your face, it doesn't get any less sweet every year.
No, absolutely not. Every time it's so different and it's unbelievable to be on this podium again. And I feel we have been fighting for this all season and preparing for it. And we're super happy that we made it. Of course, it was really tight at the end there, but luckily we made it.
Well, talk to me about the final 5-6 minutes where in the attack nothing was happening, the goals weren't coming, but you kept keeping them out in defense. What was going through your mind? Were you begging for a goal?
Yeah, I was, but at the same time I was feeling that I needed one more save, so I was just focusing to try to take the next ball and be ready for this. And luckily the last ball there, I was there, and I'm really happy that mentally I was prepared.
And in a squad full of such talented players, it's really hard to point out anyone in particular, but also to hear that you're the MVP, it must be special to see your contribution also be rewarded like that.
Absolutely. Right now I don't even remember the match, but I was just focusing before this match to, if I get a chance, I want to give everything, because I love to play in this team, and to be able to be in the goal in this team, it's a great honor.
And talk to me then, around the 15-minute mark is when you came into the game, and the opening 15 minutes were so frantic. They was non-stop from both sides, and then the timeout came as well. You managed to calm things down and really take control as a team. What was said during that timeout? What was being said on the bench to really calm the team down?
We needed to make more fault in defense. We weren't good enough in the defense, and when we started to do this, we changed the match, and we kept on believing this is the way we will win, and I feel we managed to do this.
It worked out. Congratulations, 3 years in a row. Thank you very much for talking to us.
videoing.
So here at Corey Bratson now, we spoke at the beginning of the weekend. Little did we know that 2 days later, you would have had a perfect shooting record, 11 out of 11. I don't know if you even remember that, but a perfect shooting over the weekend, and you've won the title. How does it feel to actually get this weekend over with and come out with the trophy in your hands, as we saw?
Oh my God, it's impossible to describe this feeling. With the fans and this amazing arena, I am so happy and I'm so proud of the team.
How does it compare with like the dreams and the expectations beforehand? Has it exceeded everything? Could you have imagined it to be like this?
No, I couldn't imagine. This is crazy. I had the best feeling the whole weekend. I think the team did so good together, and we just keep on moving and pushing each other, and we win in the end, and that's perfect.
Talk to me about after the first 15 minutes of the game, which were absolutely frenetic. I mean, both sides going at like 200 miles an hour, more goals in minutes. What was said during that timeout, which really, it seemed to calm the team down, it really set the defense up, and you really took control of the game from there?
Yeah, I think we just needed to calm a little bit down and stay together, like you said, in the defense, and trust each other and trust the team, and it worked.
And as I said before, 11 out of 11 for you, every single time you got your hands on the ball, if it wasn't a foul, it was a goal. How did it feel playing on the line over the weekend? Because it seemed like everything worked perfectly.
No, it really felt amazing to be in this team and to play Final Four, and also to do so well. It's really exceeded my expectation, and I'm really happy to have been a part of this.
Congratulations very much, and enjoy the celebrations.
Oh.
I'm very happy.
It gets better every time.
Every time, but I didn't want to suffer so much today. But I think my mom and my father have a good heart now, because of course we're testing it. But yeah, it's amazing. We have an amazing team. I'm so glad we make it one more time.
And every single time you just seem to pop up with the goals. They're not the prettiest of goals at times, but you manage to get it into the back of the net. I mean, there's just these events and these finals just give you something special, something extra every time.
Of course, I think that this is the moment we have to enjoy. And of course, you need a little bit lucky sometimes, but this team give us such a fantastic atmosphere. We give so much support to each other. It's so nice. Sometimes we make mistakes, we feel a little bit bad. It's a mental holy coaster during this match, but we look to each other and say, just keep going, you have to fight until the end. And we did it. It was very nice.
What was going through your mind in those final five? Well, I think it was almost 7 minutes at the end without a goal, and they just came closer and closer and closer.
I didn't realize that, but this match looked like it was 3 hours. Yeah. The last maybe 45 seconds, it was like, come on, time, a little bit faster. But yeah, it was very nice feeling. We knew from the beginning, from the first day, that we really wanted this title. We had some girls which didn't experience this to have the first title, so also it was amazing to make for them. I don't know, it was a really good season, and we just enjoyed this last match.
That was 100% deserved. Five titles for you, congratulations.
Yes, it's very nice.
Well done, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, thank you. Thank you for the support.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this final press conference of this year's Dello Group Women's EHF Final Four. Last year's winner and the year's winner before is also the winner this year. So Gyuri Aude at UKC have achieved the triple at the Women's EHF Final Four, and they've beaten Rostov Don in the final to achieve so. For this press conference, I welcome, first of all, a special guest, Sindre. Welcome. And I also welcome of Gyuri Aude at UKC, the goalkeeper in this tournament's MVP, Kari Alva Grimsbo, and their coach, Gabor Dani. And of Rostov Don, I welcome head coach Ambros Martin and Louis Abing. Ambros, first question to you. There were a lot of ups and downs in this match. You were ahead at the beginning. You were trailing by quite a few goals at halftime. You came back and it was very close. From your point of view, now that a bit of time has settled, can you talk us through the match?
Yes, but let me first to congratulate Gabor and Eto players and their fans because of the game today, because of the victory, because of the fantastic season. So congratulations, you know. And also to my players, because we have to be really proud about them to play this type of match here in front of fantastic atmosphere with all of these fans supporting the home team was amazing. We were close, it's true. The result also say that. But I think the key of the game today was in the first half, was not at the end. And some important details, like when you are one more and you don't realize about, or you are not effective in this situation, like you must too. We start really well the match. We controlled the situation. We wanted to play like this 60 minutes. We knew also it was very difficult because yesterday was a tough match for us because also in front this year they play high level intensity all the time. And in the moment we lost this control, in the moment we lost somehow the, and we lost the, we didn't dominate the game. And they could run and score goals in contact. That was much difficult for us and much better for them because the only way is to make some pressure. We try also to do that in the second half at the beginning. We couldn't, and I repeat, we got the chance. And when you play this type of match and you are under and you don't realize this, let's say, things after is impossible. But even with this, we try until the very last second. We got the chance, but it was a bit late. So we have to be really happy, because of the result, but really satisfied and proud of my team, of all of these players and also of our fans who came here and support us here and also in Russia.
Gabor, ahead of this Final Four and the potential meetup with Rostov and Ambros, obviously a lot has been written, a lot has been talked about the special relationship that you have. Now that you're here and that you've, with Gyur, have won this Final Four, what does this mean to you?
Yes, this was very special for me and for my team. This situation is Ambros. I have a big respect and big honor, and I know him. And but I have to put out this feeling. Now this game is the final. We want to play our game, our attack, and our system when we was before. And the first half was very difficult when the start, the beginning, the game. They make excellent defense and excellent feeling. But after we give answer, I think this was the question. Ambros mentioned this. But I think very, very proud of my team, and I want feeling and enjoy this time and this feeling. I am very proud, and thank you so much, my team, and our fans. It was fantastic, and our feeling was fantastic. And thank you so much for everything. First of all, with Kari in the goal, and for us, it doesn't matter who will start. For example, the play in the goal, Kari, when she came, she did an excellent performance.
Luis, obviously the memories are now very fresh, and obviously there's disappointment. But what do you think when you look back at this tournament tomorrow, in a week's time? What do you think you can take out of this for next season?
I think in the end we can be proud that we never gave up. I think this was the most important to keep fighting until the end. And I think we showed a really good team spirit in these last 2 days. But I think maybe we were maybe a little bit too eager in the first half to expand our advantage. And then we made some easy mistakes. But I think it will take a few days, of course, to be proud because everyone now is really sad. But we just keep on working, keep on continuing, and next year it's another chance.
Kari, Gabor mentioned this, that yesterday was Amandine Gol who produced a fantastic performance. Today was you who saved a number of balls. And let's not forget Eva Kiss, who can always save a penalty, or if you remember last year, can also decide a game. Can you tell us a bit about the relationship you have among your goalkeepers, and what makes this trio so special?
We are three really good goalkeepers. I'm super proud of the job we do together. We really have room for each other. We help each other in the best way we can. And I think for all of us, it's not important who's in the goal. The most important is that the goalkeepers do a good job. And my only goal today before the match was to prepare, and if I got a chance to be on the field, I wanted to give all. I wanted to stay calm, and I wanted to focus on the ball and give something for my team, and this was the only focus I had. I didn't think too much who was on the other side. It could be any team. We know these finals, it's always difficult, it's always close, no matter what the score is at some point, and I think after the first 15 minutes in the first half, we find the recipe. We started to make fault in the defense and make a really good defense and fighting for each other. And I think for us, this was the recipe for the winning today.
Thank you. I'd like to open the floor for questions.
Sindre.
Are you satisfied with Mami's performance today?
Mondta, igen, szeretne mondani valamit. He say yes, I want something.
Yeah. You're going to celebrate tonight or tomorrow with the team.
It's going to be fun.
All right. Are there any further questions? Then I'd like to thank everyone very much. Thank you in particular to the two teams. Kari, Sindre, Gabor, Amos, Luis, thank you very much. My last task always is to read out the winners of the media quiz, and I'm just doing this very quickly. Xavier Donferrand from Radio France, Paul Henter, Amina Idrizi, Ibolia Sekeres, if I'm not mistaken, and Iyum Alet Iyum, and you can pick up your prizes at the media info desk. Thank you very much. See you all next year.
Thank you so much.
2018, 2019.